This is E658, lecture 47. In the last class, we saw the following. That is, if you imagined the LFS and the quantizer we saw that you can in principle choose L of S to result in a noise transfer function that you want. Okay. For example sake, we considered a first order noise transfer function and then found that L of S should be an integrate. The next thing, so you can choose the next thing we said was continuous time delta sigma modulators offer inherent anti-aliasing. Simply because the loop filter output is what is sampled, you are not So continuous time delta sigma modulators offer inherent anti-aliasing because we are not sampling the input right up front and then processing it subsequently. What we are doing is actually sampling the output of the loop filter, and we know that the loop filter is some kind of low pass filter function, right? It's got a high gain at low frequencies and the gain keeps falling off at frequencies with frequency. So when you put in a sine wave at in the alias band, which is a narrow frequency band in and around multiples of FS, we find that the gain of the loop filter is very, very small for all frequencies in the alias band, which means that, you know, the loop is virtually dead for all frequencies which are sitting in the alias band, alright. In other words, the delta sigma modulator output is an accurate representation of the input when the input lies at low frequencies, but it in fact at multiples of FS, you can show that the signal transfer function in fact actually goes through what? What is the STF at FS? If the NTF is 1 minus the inverse, what is the STF at FS? It is actually 0. Alright. Because we saw that the STF of the function of j omega is nothing but L of j omega times NTF of j omega, right. The NTF of j omega is basically NTF of e to the j omega, which is the discrete time variable, which is and a periodic extension of it, alright. So at low frequencies, NTF of j omega is approximately 1 over L of j omega. So the two cancel out and the signal transfer function is approximately 1. At frequencies around FS, you find that the loop gain function, the NTF is still very, very low because the NTF at FS must be the same as the NTF at 0, alright. And which basically means that at multiples of FS, the noise transfer function magnitude in fact is 0, which means that there is a notch. Does make sense? And this is a very attractive thing because now it basically means that you don't need an anti-alias filter at all. You can just go and directly plug this into your signal, alright. And this will naturally reject all tones and all frequencies in and around multiples of FS. Is that clear? So that's the, that's the unique property of such A to D converters. And this is one reason why they are very, very popular nowadays, is because you can get rid of having an additional filter which is would be necessary in a discrete time model delta sigma ADC to perform anti-aliasing. All right. So let's continue on with our simple dummy case, which is the first order in delta sigma, and see what all can go wrong there. And the same thing will hold for higher order loops also. We were all discussing this these properties with respect to a first order modulator. Okay, very similar stuff will happen also for higher order modulators. That is delta sigma loops where the noise transfer function is not 1 minus z inverse, but something of the form 1 minus z inverse to the n divided by some d of z, because we said that if you just use 1 minus z inverse whole to the n, the input to the quantizer will get, the quantizer will get overloaded because the input to the quantizer is this quantization noise propagating through the loop, and the input, the transfer function from the quantization noise to the input of the quantizer is nothing but NTF of Z minus 1. Is clear? Okay. So, let's see what all can go wrong. So what did we assume was, what did we assume in this case for the quantizer delay? We assume the first assumption we made was that quantizer delay was 0, which is clearly not a correct assumption. In other words, we assume that the quantizer delay is 0 and we push the real delay through the loop. Through the loop filter, as long as we don't have a delay-free loop around the quantizer, we are okay. That's as far as mathematics is concerned. But in practice, you've designed quantizers, right? For example, in one of your assignments, you did a 4-bit ADC. So you know that the sampling instant is something, and the decision is only available a small time later, where that small time depends on the regeneration and capabilities of the comparators and so on. Okay, so there is always going to be finite time taken between the sampling instant and the time at which the decision is made. So in practice what happens therefore is that there is the ADC which is sampling at a time 0, and equivalently the decision is only available a little later, alright. So it is equivalent to delaying the feedback pulse by, so ideally without quantizer delay, if the ADC clock the ADC samples on this edge, the decision of the ADC is also available right away, okay, let's say a fraction of a picosecond later. So this is the time at which the ADC decision is available, and this simultaneously goes to the DAC, correct? So the DAC will put out the ADC input code times a pulse. This is 1 second, this is one full clock period. Okay, so this is the back pulse. In other words, if I put a small impulse in front of the ADC will sample it, make a decision right away, send out a digital word which will get then decoded by the DAC, and the DAC will put out a DAC pulse, and all this happens in, you know, before you can say Jack Robinson, right? So it happens very, very quick. Okay. In practice, of course, there is always delay. In other words, the ADC samples here, it takes some time to make a decision. That decision is conveyed to the DAC, and the DAC then looks at that the digital word coming in and then puts out a pulse. So in other words, the real DAC pulse is actually coming like this. Okay. So what is the delay? What is the delay here? Between which two points am I supposed to look at the delay? So this is the delay. Is that clear? You understand? So all that has happened is the following, that is, it is equivalent, so this is exactly equivalent to adding a delay in the feedback pulse, correct? Is this clear? Earlier when the sampling rate rises, the DAC pulse comes out at the same time, so the feedback path basically has got simply an energy pulse, okay, and that's what it was without the delay. Now with delay, alright, this is the equal. So what do you expect? I mean, clearly one thing to expect is that now once you introduce a delay in the feedback loop, the NTF must change. Why do you think the NTF changes? How will I figure out the NTF now? Oh, how did I figure out the NTF when TD was 0? No, I know, but how will I figure out what the NTF of the loop now is? That's the question. Pardon? Replace? I can't hear you, man. Yes, okay. And? So, we have to find the loop gain and then. So, earlier what were we doing? We were putting an impulse, so this will give the. So, ideal case. You put in an impulse in E of N, this will give you a rise to an energy pulse at the output of the DAC. This goes through the loop filter, which is 1 over S, and then generate something like this. We sample the output of the loop at these points, alright, and conclude that this is nothing but Z inverse by 1 minus Z, the sample. Does it make sense? Alright, now what should we do? This is 0, this is TD, this is 1 plus TD. Correct? The DAC makes a decision, I mean the flash makes a decision, or the ADC makes a decision, conveys that decision to the DAC time TD later. Hopefully TD is a small number, and then the DAC acts. The DAC will still put out a pulse which is 1 clock period wide, okay. So it tries, its continuous time waveform will have a step at TD and will fall down at 1 plus TD. Clear? Okay. Now what happens? This goes through the integrator. What happens to the output? So this is 0, this is 1, 2, 3 and 4. What happens? This starts ramping at TD. Alright. And the samples are taken at what time? The please note, the ADC is sampling at 0, 1, 2 and so on. So on. Alright. So what is the Z transform of this guy now? Yes, Rakshit. So what is this? Okay. What is this value? What is the slope of that line? Slope is 1. Okay. So what should, what is this? What is this? TD. The slope is 1. So what should this be? 1 minus TD. Is that clear? Alright. So the sequence is nothing but 0, 1 minus TD, 1, 1, 1, blah, 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 instead of 0, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1. Correct? So this has a transform Z inverse by 1 minus Z inverse minus TD Z inverse. Alright. So what is the NTF? Is 1 by 1 plus L of Z, which is 1 by 1 plus Z inverse by 1 minus Z inverse minus TD. Correct? And what is this? Multiply the numerator and denominator by 1 minus Z inverse and I will get 1 minus TD Z inverse times 1 minus Z inverse. Does it make sense? Okay. So alright. So a couple of things to notice. First of all, the NTF is definitely changed from what it was to something else. Okay. Thankfully, when TD is 0, you get back what you expect. Otherwise, you made a mistake. Alright. So, what do you think happens to the low frequency? What happens to the, for small values of TD, what do you think happens to the noise shaping? No, it is first order, sure. But does it, is it affected or? It's not really affected because for small frequency, what happens, what is that? For DC or low frequencies, you know, e to the j omega is approximately 1. which basically means that the denominator will reduce to 1, alright, okay. So, one thing we have observed is that, things are not screwing up at, the NTF is not losing, its high pass nature definitely, and at low frequencies, the gain seems roughly the same. Any intuition on why this makes sense? Pardon? So the intuition behind why the NTF gain doesn't change at low frequencies is that at very low frequencies that basically means that the input and the feedback quantity is changing very slowly, right? Which basically means that if something is changing very slowly, you delay it a little bit, it's pretty much the same. Okay, that's the intuition why. Even though there's a phase shift in the input, right, to the loop filter, at low frequencies it doesn't make any difference. Okay, so what do you think will happen to the poles of the so now clearly the poles which were earlier when TD was 0, where are all the poles? There was one pole at the origin, right? So now where are the poles? What are the poles doing? Come on, people. The poles are at now. I can't be offering you rewards for finding the roots of a quadratic. Yes, quick. Alright. Okay. So, you get some nasty looking expression like this. The only thing I can make out from this is that if TD becomes very large, what happens to the magnitude of the roots? What do you want the root, where do you want the poles to be, bottom line, before we? You want the poles to be inside the unit circle. Another, one thing that you notice now is that the order of the system has gone up by, which was early, it was the first order system earlier. Now, because of this excess delay, the order of the system has gone up by 1, alright. So, the order is 2, even though there is only 1 0 at, there is a 0 at, okay, zeros are the ones which are helping you noise shape, alright. So, even though the order has increased from 1 to 2, the number of zeros at z equal to 1 have not changed, okay. So, the increased order is not really helping you in noise shaping, that is one thing. The second thing is that there are now two poles, and clearly as TD becomes larger and larger, okay, when TD tends to infinity, where are the poles, guys? Definitely poles are at plus minus root TD is where the poles will be, alright. So, as TD becomes larger and larger, the poles will get out of the unit circle at some point in time, which basically means that the modulator becomes unstable, alright. So, too much TD means the loop is unstable. As poles move, alright. Okay, so any intuition on this? Okay, So, I mean, is this something, you know, you're like all surprised by, or you couldn't care less if the loop became unstable, or you knew this all along?
When A was very large for all frequencies, the system was unstable because there was too much delay in the feedback.
Yes. Okay. So the argument is that, I mean, while we are looking at this in the context of a discrete time system, we know that delay is always problematic for a feedback loop. Okay. I mean, it's like saying, you know, if we gave your quiz papers like 3 semesters later, right? Basically the whole system will go into chaos, okay, because there is so much delay between the point of measurement and the feedback that you basically guys couldn't care less what happened in the 3 semesters, you know, you understand. So, the same thing about, you know, whenever I ask you to switch on or switch off a light or a fan, it's always easier to figure out which light it is to switch on because there is no delay at all. You switch on the switch, and if it corresponds to the light, you get the feedback signal right away, okay. But if it's a fan, it takes a while for you to figure out whether the fan is, you know, speeding up or slowing down, okay. And of course, you know, you're eager to finish your job and sit down in the class and listen to me, so you're trying to turn this on and off, right? Which basically means that, you know, basically the whole thing will drive you crazy, okay. So we always know, and you know, all this Bode, you know, plot and this phase margin and all that. Phase margin is nothing but equivalent to delay in time. If you put a sine wave, there is no difference between, phase is nothing but equivalent to a time delay. Correct? So that's this whole phase margin discussion that you have seen and control and all this stuff is basically also telling you the same story, which is if the delay in the loop is too much, or in other words, the phase of the loop gain is too high, okay, then the loop can go unstable, alright. So, at face value, this doesn't look surprising at all, or at least it shouldn't look surprising, okay. So, it turns out that in this case, you can go and do the math and find how much TD you require before the loop becomes unstable, alright. It turns out that as the order of the loop filter becomes higher and higher, this excess delay problem will become more and more problematic, okay. So, the amount of time delay you can tolerate before the loop goes unstable becomes very, very little, okay. So, the amount of TD tolerable before which loop goes unstable goes down with loop order. Okay, is there any intuition behind this statement? Why do you think this is true? Or why do you think this makes sense? Yes, so what?
Increase in order, we have more number of poles, which also contribute.
Yes, so what?
Effective total amount of delay in the loop is.
Okay, so as you increase the loop filter order, the NTF order, what happens? There are two things happening. First, there are extra poles, which themselves add, you know, phase shift and cause delay. Not only that, the gain of the loop filter is also increasing, because presumably you wanted a larger order loop filter simply to get more and more gain, correct? So, the gain is increasing, the phase is increasing, so the amount of error or margin you have before the loop goes unstable becomes very, very small, okay? So, while, you know, I'm not going to prove this, it makes sense, and definitely that's something that people see all the time. So, excess loop delay, this problem is called the problem of excess loop delay in continuous time delta sigma modulators, okay, alright. Yes, so if you go and do, yes, so where are the zeros? there is one at the origin, what about the other one? What is this? This is Z minus 1 divided by Z. Yeah, okay. This is Z into Z minus 1. Yeah, blah blah blah. Z square minus TDZ plus 1. Plus TD. Yeah, there is 1 0 at 0 and there is 1 0 at Z equal to 1. The Z at Z equal to 0 is not doing anything for you. The Z at Z equal to 1 is helping you noise shape, right? So the Z at Z equal to 0, the 0 at Z equal to 0 is not helpful to you at all. Okay. Alright. So you understand. So this problem of excess loop delay is an issue with continuous time delta sigma modulator. So we have to figure out what you can do to, this is the problem. So we have to figure out what to do to fix the problem. So unless you understand the problem carefully, you will not be able to fix it. So let us take a look at it and see what you can do to fix it. So what is the problem? Oh no, 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 let's not change the pulse shape. One suggestion is use a pulse shape. That makes sense because in our earlier discussion, I'll come back to that. Okay. So those of you who've been following the discussion carefully, you would have realized that putting an RZ pulse shape will allow you to tolerate a lot more, delay than an NRZ pulse shape. But we'll take that for later. If you want to have the NRZ pulse shape for the DAC, looking at these expressions, is there anything that comes to mind? What is the culprit? Oh no, no, you can't fool with the sampling instant. If you say I will now delay the sampling instant, then the next time the DAC pulse will get delayed by 2D. Okay? So that's not a solution either. Alright. Anything you can see here? If what term wasn't there, your life would be easy. TD is inverse. So in other words, minus TD is inverse. This is the problem term. Correct? In other words, if I put in, this is the NRZ pulse. If I put in an impulse here and sample the output, I am getting at this point, I am getting an equivalent, this thing which is Z inverse by 1 minus Z inverse, right? So this must be, please note that all this is minus because we said we always neglect the negative term, we assume it's there all along, okay? So instead of getting minus Z inverse by 1 minus Z inverse, we are getting minus of Z inverse by 1 minus Z inverse minus TD Z inverse. So if we somehow added TD Z inverse in the feedback loop, so in other words, instead of just feeding this directly, we had to add so the solution is to subtract TD Z inverse from this expression, correct? which is equivalent to saying how will I so I need a loop filter which basically so there is always a minus, there is already a minus here. So in other words, the loop filter must have a do you guys understand? I see a lot of blank faces. Okay, let me explain that again. So thanks to this TD, if I put an impulse, launch an impulse, discrete time impulse here at t equal to 0, then what will happen? It will, the DAC will convert into a continuous time impulse which will go through the energy pulse, which will go through the delay and excite the integrator. And if I go and find, if sample the output of the integrator, okay, and take the Z transform of the sequence, it turns out to be this chap, correct? So the problem as we saw was this TD Z inverse. So the solution is to get rid of this TD Z inverse. In other words, you add, you have another path which adds TD Z inverse, okay. So I mean, if you are confused by this negative stuff, earlier I would put a negative impulse, okay, and I will get Z inverse by 1 minus Z inverse minus TD Z inverse. Now all that I have to do is I have to add a path, somehow I have to get this TD Z inverse into the out, correct? In other words, I need right. So in other words, I need another path which, for example, could take the output here, alright, or the output here and generate something which is proportional to TD Z inverse. Okay. So there are many ways of doing it. One way of doing it is to say, okay, let me freeze the point at which I pick my output to be here, because practically that's the earliest time anything is available, right? Because this quantizer sample given your decision, then the DAC waveform is available only TD later, okay? So if I constrain that the earliest point I can pick anything off in practice is the output of the DAC, all right? And if I want, this is an analog quantity, so one thing I can do is to say, if I want another path, so I need to add something, alright. I am trying to figure out what I need to add, what I need to put in this, you know, in this black box, such that I will be able to get Z inverse by 1 minus Z inverse after I sample. Correct? So any suggestions? Pardon? So this is already an analog quantity.
We need to model the
No. This is a delay of TD which all exists within the ADC DAC, okay? There is nothing you can do about this whole part. The earliest you have access to an analog signal is the output of the DAC, which only happens TD after the sampling instant. Correct? The question is, I mean, we all agree that we need to add another path, okay, which has a gain, which after sampling will give you an equivalent transfer function Z inverse times TD. Is that clear? Yeah, so, okay, so, okay, so, see the signal at this point is what? This is TD, this is 1 plus TD, that is the signal X, okay. Alright, and the value at the output of the integrator, the waveform at the output of the integrator is simply this guy here, which goes from 0 to 1 TD, this is 1 plus TD. Okay. Okay, now, and we are sampling at, okay, alright, so we need to do something such that we need to add some waveform which when sampled will give you we need to do this, we need to add to this something which will give you alright, and what should this value be? TD. We need to add a waveform before the sampler such that after the sampler or the samples at integer multiples of time are these things, which it is 1 at t equal to 1. Does this make sense at all? Okay? Alright. So, so how many ways are there of doing this? No, that's not the question. The question is how many ways are there of generating a waveform before the sampler whose samples are this? There are infinite ways of doing this. Okay? Alright? Does this make sense? Okay. So, I mean if you don't believe me, this is one answer, okay. This is another answer, okay. You understand? So, okay. Now, what do you think is the simplest way of doing it? So, you can, one way of doing this is to notice that this fellow, okay, is one precisely at when sampled at t equal to 1 and 0 at all other instances. So, instead of trying to synthesize some funky waveform which goes through all these, you know, which is TD at 1 point and 0 elsewhere, we can say we take the same way out and we already have a waveform which is 1 at t equal to 1 and 0 elsewhere. So, all that you need to do is you multiply this by TD and add it. Does this make sense? Okay. So, so take this, multiply by TD, alright. So, this will give you a waveform which does this. Okay. And I wish to reiterate that this is definitely not the only way of doing things. All that you need to do is to find some waveform which will take on, which will be 0 elsewhere and be TD at t equal to 1. Correct? Okay. So, now what should be there in that block? This is nothing but a gain of we have put in a negative impulse here.
The one which comes after the loop is actually negative. You have to add.
Yeah, you have to add. So, in other words, what you have to add, it should be in the same polarity as the integrated output.
Yes.
Yes. So, this should be.
So, if you put a negative impulse here, there you get a positive impulse. But here,
no. I am putting a negative impulse here,
yes.
Correct?
What comes after the loop filter is positive.
What comes out of the loop filter here is at this point negative. Please note that we have to add, I think there is some confusion because, so what I have to do is I have to add this TDZ inverse, correct? This and the sign of the integrated output should be the same, correct? So, what I should do is add something with a gain TD, correct? Alright? Okay. And so, this is what I should do, which basically means that the loop will look like this is the integrator. This is the subtraction, okay. This is the gain block whose gain is minus TD, right? Okay. See, please note that there is a subtraction here, so there must be a subtraction here also, okay. And this output is sampled by the quantizer. This is the return to zero pulse, and there is a the time delay TD, which I will just denote. Alright. Please don't confuse the gain block of minus TD with a time delay TD. Okay. This is a gain whereas this is a time delay. Okay. So, intuitively why does this block diagram make sense? Why are things becoming less stable when there is delay? Okay, so you can see that, that's the restatement of what I've done in English. Okay, I think you get the point. So, the bottom line is the following, right? When there's a feedback loop, the feedback needs to come quickly. Some part of it must at least come quickly. You can't take your own time, own sweet time to feed the signal back. If you take your own sweet time, the loop will go unstable. As you can see, when there is delay in the loop, the signal fed back right away is decreasing. Correct? So, if you want to fix the loop, You know that this fellow is going to take forever, right? And you can't wait for him. So what should you do? You have another path whose job is to just supply feedback quickly and shut up after that, okay? The rest of the feedback is provided by the integral, okay? Yet another way of looking at it is, if you have two parallel paths between, there is one path like this, there is another path like this. What is this equivalent to? This is equivalent to adding, whenever you have two signal paths going to the output, you have transmission zeros, correct? And you know that adding a zero in a feedback loop is one way of stabilizing the feedback loop by, you know, increasing the phase margin, which is equivalent to saying that when you add a zero, what happens? I mean, the zero has got high frequency gain, so it basically gives you very, very quick, I mean, gives you information about what is fed back quick, alright? You understand? So, and as you can, if you kind of look at it another way, you can see that this path here is nothing but a direct path around the quantizer, which doesn't bother to go through the loop filter at all, okay? And it turns out that this is one standard way of stabilizing continuous time delta sigma modulators for excess loop delay. That is, you add a direct path around the okay. The same thing is also applicable to higher order quantizers, higher order delta sigma modulators. The moment there is excess loop delay, you can always clean it up by adding a direct path around the quantizer. I mean, even in a high order loop filter, basically all that will happen is that when I whack the loop filter with NRZ pulse, the output, instead of coming out right away, will take some time because of the delay through the flash DAC path. Which basically means that I will be sampling the wrong values, the NTF will change. Most of the time the NTF will go unstable if the TD becomes significant. So physically it means that the feedback is not coming quick enough, or the amount of feedback coming in the next sample is very small, which means that, you know, one way I can help the loop is by giving feedback right away. You understand? Alright. So, yes sir, pardon, I mean, okay, this assumes that I know TD, and then I can realize again, if I know TD, I can fix the loop. That's what this discussion is telling, correct? I mean, if I don't know TD, obviously I can't fix the, yes sir.
Now, what is the condition of TD?
What is the condition on TD? No, this all these diagrams are valid as long as TD is less than one sample. Okay. Now, if the TD becomes more than one sample, then you're in deep shit. I mean, that's okay. A gentle way of putting it. Hopefully, you never design a sigma delta where the TD is. Rather, let me take my words back. You will typically not design a sigma delta with where TD is more than one sample. Okay, because it's already hard enough stabilizing stuff where this is a small fraction of the period. All right. So, to give you an analogy,